This is Right from the Deep.
I'm Karen Ball.
And I'm Erin Taylor Young. And this is the podcast from writers for writers, answering the question,
why am I doing this?
As writers, editors,
and a former literary agent,
we're in the deep with you,
bringing interviews, inspiration, and information to encourage, refresh, and equip you to embrace the deep, to find your truest story, your truest message in the deep places.
You can get the episode show notes, lots more information and encouragement, and your free audio download, 5 crucial ways to safeguard your writer's heart at writefromthedeep.com. Welcome, everybody. We're glad you're here with us in the deep. So, are you guys like me? Do you feel like today's world is really superficial? I asked my sociologist husband if that were true or if I was, you know, just imagining things. I'm like, what are the signs that prove we live in a superficial world? And I expected him to give me like this answer full of deep sociological insight. And instead he said, the Kardashians being famous. Like, okay then. But yet, it really is probably true. Think about how many people are interested in something like that and they follow them. Or think about how easily we're bored or how our attention spans seem to keep shrinking and we have this steady stream or maybe better words, constant bombardment of superficial input from all forms of media like, you know, advertisements, TV, LinkedIn, Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, Tumblr, Twaddle, Tweedle, whatever, you know, it's all a mile wide and an inch deep. And I think we're more apt to react. You know, we type off some quick response or better yet, we click a button, you know, a thumbs up button, and then we move on to the next thing that's flashing at us. And before we know it, maybe an hour or two or more has passed and all we've been doing is waiting in the shallows.
Yeah, I love that phrase. All we've been doing is waiting in the shallows. But why is that a problem? I mean, sometimes on a hot day, it's nice to wait in the shallows. Well, here's the reason superficiality is a problem in our lives. Well, for one thing, it creates isolation. You know, we talked about that in episode number 50. But friends, we've been made in the image of God. Do you really get that? Look at yourself, not if you're driving, but look at yourself in the mirror and say, I've been made in the image of God. He gave us a brain with the ability to think, to ponder, to reason through things, to enjoy beauty, to appreciate the wonder of God. He created us for relationship, for fellowship. We're selling ourselves short on what God intends for us to be and do and what our relationships can be and what he intends for his body, the church, when we settle for these superficial encounters and living life waiting in the shallows.
Okay, so we're going to be in agreement here. Superficiality is common. But let's talk about why. Why are we not going deep?
Well, for one thing, it takes time to go deep. I mean, it's so easy, like you said, just to hit the like button, the little heart thing, put in a little emoji, and then we move on. We're rushing all the time. Don't you feel like that?
Yeah.
That we're rushing to this appointment and to that meeting and to everything, in everything. We're always in a hurry, trying to cram as much in the time that we have. There's just too much to do, too many expectations, and not enough time to do it all. We also live in an instant society. You can get instant gratification, no waiting, no patience required, and we get frustrated. Guys, we get frustrated when a website takes 5 seconds to load.
Yeah. Or we can't even wait, you know, or look at something for more than 5 seconds. You know, it's so short. Okay, so yes, time. It takes time to go deep. And another issue with the whole time thing, because we live in this increasingly culture of digital natives. That's what they talk. We have a name, digital natives, people who've grown up using computers, and digital immigrants, people who have adopted computers. This is our culture now, okay? And because of that, we're faced with information overload like never ever before. And it's not always meaningful information. And so here we are, we're sorting, we're multitasking, we're dealing with multiple relationships online and texts. And so I was reading about this conference. It's called the Informed Brain in a Digital World. And They had a keynote speaker named Clifford Noss of Stanford, and he was talking about this information overload, and he had this idea of a media budget. So what he's saying is that when some new type of media emerges, it basically takes time away from the other media in our daily time budget. So he says that when additional media appear, there's no time left in a person's daily media budget, so people begin to double book media time. So here we have these personal computers and tablets and smartphones, and they make it very, very easy to do several things at once, to use them all at once. I don't know about you guys, but I'm sitting here with my computer on, and I got my cell phone next to me because I need to sometimes use them both. That's me multitasking. This is bad. What he says is that multitasking is inefficient, and we've talked about that, but it decreases productivity. But here's the important thing. It may be hindering our cognitive function. So we're actually messing with our brains here. And another thing they talked about with time at this conference, they're saying, you know, more and more of our relationships seem to be moving online. And they were discussing the long-term effects of that. Yes, it's great that the internet allows us to connect with people we never could have before. But some researchers are saying that these purely online relationships can lead to impaired emotional and social development.
Yeah, just what we need.
I know, right? But part of that is because we need strong ties for support and emotional development. But social media allows us to maintain these relationships with very weak ties. And so the concern that they have is that these increasing amount of weak ties are coming at the expense of strong ties because we only have so much time to devote.
A follow-up on this is we often don't go deep because as much as we hate to admit it or acknowledge it, our brains are forgetting how to do it. There's a book called The Shallows by Nicholas Carr, and it talks about how the web has rewired our brains. And understand, we're not saying, ooh, internet, web, evil. We're saying be strategic about what you do and don't give away the time and the brain power that you have to something that's going to work against you. So the internet has actually changed the way we think and process, according to this book. One of the quotes in the book says, a search engine often draws our attention to a particular snippet of text, a few words or sentences that have strong relevance to whatever we're searching for at the moment. And yet it provides little incentive for taking in the work as a whole. We don't see the forest when we search the web. We don't even see the trees. We see twigs and leaves. Guys, think about that. You're not seeing the forest. You're not seeing the trees. You just see little bits and pieces. And we take those as gospel. And a lot of studies show now that skimming is far more common. We used to skim to find something we wanted to read more deeply. It was a process. You'd skim, you'd hit on something, and then you'd go deeper. But now we skim, and what we find on the surface is the end goal. We get just enough information, just enough of a quote, so we feel as though we understand, or to find the points on which to base our beliefs or our stand about something. Shoot, we even do this with the Bible, and that's called proof texting. And friends, that can be extremely dangerous. Yeah. As one quote about proof texting goes, quote, a text without a context is a pretext for a proof text. A text without a context is a pretext for a proof text. So what does that mean? Basically, you're taking something totally out of context and you're using that to prove what you want without any regard for whether it really does prove it. There are verses that strike me as I'm reading, but you know, the first thing that I do when I'm reading through scripture and a particular verse really hits me, I go back and I read it in context. I read the chapter, I read the section, sometimes I read the book. Sure, maybe God is wanting you to notice that one verse and wanting it to hit you and impact you, but maybe he's using that verse that strikes you to draw you into a deeper study. So I want you to stop, but I'm worried that the people who are driving, I know you know not to just stop in the middle of traffic, but I want you to think about this. When is the last time you read through a whole chapter, an entire letter, or even an entire book of the Bible in one sitting? Just sat down and read it through as though you were reading any other book. Read it through in one setting.
You know, when we're talking about reading books, the author of that book, The Shallows, Nicholas Carr, he talks about this whole process. You know, like actually, when you're reading a book, like, you know, the old fashioned thing with paper, actual paper,
yeah,
you guys,
yeah, yeah.
when you do that, it allows you to control the pace of information that's coming at you because it's slow and the brain is actually understimulated with just, you know, you and the white page and the words. So you can think deeply and you can connect what you're reading to your own framework of ideas in your brain, and it connects to your long-term memory. Okay, so that's what you can do with a real book. And he talks about how memory works. And he says that if you were exposed to something, but you're not given time to digest it, it doesn't stick. So it's interesting that if you have that book in your hands, some people would tell you, and Nicholas would agree, that you can learn better and if you're going slowly and thinking it through. But when you're reading on the internet, the book goes on to say, if you're reading on the internet, you've got all this information and stimuli coming at you at once, and you don't have time to process. So when you're reading a book, yes, it uses visual processing and memory and language. It uses those things. But internet surfing uses that, plus it adds decision-making and problem-solving because you're always faced with like hyperlinks, so you can flip from one topic to the next. And now you actually have to multitask because you have to make decisions. Do I want to click? Do I not want to click? Do I keep reading? What do I do? And when you're doing those kind of multitasking, it actually impedes your comprehension and retention. Okay, so the bottom line to all of that is that you have to work really hard to read and retain something on the internet.
There's another book out there by Susan Greenfield that's called Mind Change, and she agrees about all these effects of digital technology. In her book, she says, our attention spans shrink, deeper thinking declines, and interpersonal bonds wither. Okay, so here we are, no attention span, no patience. And how do you think deeply without those things? How can we use the mind God gave us when we're just satisfied to skim across the surface? Hmm. We're doing ourselves, the people that we know and encounter, and God a disservice when we live life this way. You know, I admit it, I'm on social media. I love Facebook. For me, it's about relationships, but I've also used it as kind of a platform at times when I feel very strongly about something. I jump into the fray and offer my opinion. And yet, because of the way that we skim and we work on the surface, and yes, I confess, I realized I'd been doing that, our opinions are too often based on some other person's opinion, which are based on somebody else's opinions, and so on and so on. You know, guys, I've come to realize if I haven't put in the time to dig in and to study, to go deeper and really understand both sides of an issue, I need to keep my mouth and my fingers still. The world just does not need another superficial opinion. It needs thought and depth and understanding.
Yeah. Here's another quote from her book that I found fascinating. She said, the digital revolution exploits our biological propensity for mindlessness. I'm thinking, that's another way of saying we're sinners.
Yeah.
It's our sinful human nature. Romans 8:7, it talks about that sinful human nature. And it talks about our mindset. And it says the mindset of the flesh is hostile to God. So here's the thing. If we're going to let this mindless, sinful nature control the better part of our interactions, that is not going to be to our benefit, nor is it going to glorify God. So everything is kind of working against us here, guys. It's our brains. It's our natural propensity. It's no wonder we're fostering superficiality in our culture and in our relationships.
So another reason we don't go deep, as we've just outlined here, it costs us to go deep. You know, we're a culture that loves to wear masks, and we've been that kind of a culture for a long time, but it's even easier to do that now with role-playing games and with making your own avatars, and you can be whoever you want to be on the internet, and you can be whoever you want to be in person in your churches when you walk in there, and you've just come from some terrible struggle in your family, and yet you walk in smiling. And when people say, how are you doing today? You're like, we're fine. We're doing really well. Yeah, let's all lie about what's going on because we don't want to be vulnerable. I know in our world, appearances count, even in church. That's just so counter to what God is calling us to. you feel like, I feel like we're supposed to act like we have all the answers, and we're bombarded with the need to pretend to fit in or be some sort of maverick who's above it all. But both are directly opposed to what God is calling you to, and he's calling me to. Listen to 1 John 1, 5 through 8. This is the message we have heard from him and declare to you. God is light. In him there is no darkness at all. If we claim to have fellowship with him and yet walk in the darkness, in other words, if we walk in wearing masks and deceit, we lie and we do not live out the truth. But if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus, his son, purifies us from all sin. If we claim to be without sin, meaning don't have flaws or problems, no struggles, folks, we're deceiving ourselves and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, get rid of those mess, be honest, be vulnerable. God is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. We're not meant to hide our true selves, guys. You're not meant to hide your struggles. You're not meant to hide your doubts. Don't walk in darkness. Walk in his light.
And I love that he's talking about us and how we have fellowship in the light. God made us deliberately to be a connected body. 1 Corinthians 12:18 says, "But in fact, God has placed the parts in the body, every one of them, just as he wanted them to be." We're connected by truth, not by wearing masks. And I think Ephesians 4, 15 and 16 shows a little bit more about how that looks, that connection. It says, "Instead, we will speak the truth in love, growing in every way more and more like Christ, who is the head of the body, the church. He makes the whole body fit together perfectly. As each part does its own special work, it helps the other parts grow so that the whole body is healthy and strong and growing and full of love."
You know, going deep also costs us in that it requires vulnerability. That's what we've been talking about in dropping your mask. You have to be vulnerable. And too often being vulnerable makes us uncomfortable. That exposure makes us uncomfortable, like somebody's going to come down on us, especially if we're not used to it, especially if we're very protected. So what will they think about me? Will they reject me? And yeah, okay, that's a realistic worry and a realistic risk. But if somebody's going to reject you for being honest and vulnerable, that tends to be their issue. You've been walking in truth. Now, I'm not saying walk into church and burst into tears and say, "My life is terrible." What I'm saying is stop wearing a mask and stop lying. Sure, you may get hurt. But when you love someone in this way, when you open up to them, you can go deep with him. I don't know about you guys, but when you've been suffering and struggling, who's the person you want to go to talk with? It's not the person who seems to have life together. It's someone that you know who has struggled as well. That's the person that's going to come alongside you, who will know when to be quiet and when to speak truth. The person who's vulnerable is the person God can use.
When you're talking about vulnerability and pain here, yes, pain is definitely a cost of going deep. And yes, there's that pain to rejection. But there's also, I think, a pain in delving into our own pain. So often we would rather skim the surface and not deal with it at all, you know, shove it under the carpet. To understand it, though, we really have to be willing to lance the boil, you know, to dig up what we've carefully buried in order to begin the healing. When you're used to bearing pain, you're probably bearing a lot of other things with it. And pretty soon, more of you is buried, you know, than exposed. And you might not even know who you are anymore.
And you know what? There's no way to write well when you're not even sure who you are. So when we talk about the cost of going deep, sure, there are some what ifs. Like, what if I don't like who I am deep down? What if I'm really a lousy person?
That's a legitimate question. You know, or what if I discover when push comes to shove that I don't actually care deep down about things that I should care about? That's part of being a lousy person, theoretically. I don't have love that I should have. I don't have concerns. What if I discover that?
But I do want to just speak a caution here. Seeing who you really are at the core, it's not that you're lousy, it's that you're human. and you have faults and you have sins. It's not that you're a lousy person. It's that you're being honest with God. And when you're honest with God and lay yourself before Him, He can really start to work. But what if deep down, I start to wonder if I really even believe in God, or I realize I don't trust Him, or I don't even know Him? The problem is that all of these things are true in our flesh. That deathly, decaying part of us that we can't be truly free of until we go to eternity. But let's not forget that God is in the business of transforming us in the here and now through His Spirit, not in our own power. And it doesn't start with us making a decision. It simply starts with us surrendering. And that transformative power will start deep down in our heart. It's a transformation from the inside out.
I like that. I like Jesus is pretty well concerned with the inside. You know, he has some very, very harsh words for those who ignore the deep down issues or pretend that there's something they're not. You know, he was addressing the Pharisees that way. He calls them hypocrites in Matthew chapter 23:27. He says, "Hypocrites, for you are like whitewashed tombs, beautiful on the outside, but filled on the inside with dead person's bones and all sorts of impurity." It's our inside, what comes up from that heart, that's what makes us clean. That's what Jesus cares about. He says in that very same chapter, he says, "Hypocrites," again, "you are so careful to clean the outside of the cup and the dish, but inside you are filthy, full of greed and self-indulgence." You know, so the Pharisees and us may have all those what-if questions, and we might not like what we find, but Jesus is telling them, you know, first wash the inside of the cup and the dish, and the outside will become clean too. So it's okay for us to face that inside. We need to know what's going on inside and admit it and move on from there, because that's what God wants to do with us, transform from the inside out.
So, hey, we've been talking about the problems. Let's talk about some solutions. I mean, storms are going to come and they're going to beat against us, but we want to stand firm, planted on a sure foundation. So how do we do that? First, you pray. Pray for a willing spirit and the ability to get out of the shallow places in life, to escape the trivial. Yep, the internet, our iPhones, TV, all of those things that are addicting, and there's scientific evidence showing that they are. Pray to set your mind on deeper things, on things that please God, on how He sees us and how He sees the people around us.
And then know that going deep takes time. And we need to make that time. We need to commit that time, both time with God and time with people. So schedule it. If that's how it works for you to make that time, then do it. I always tell my husband, if it's not on my to-do list, it's not going to happen. But I schedule it. You know, Karen and I work together for quite a long time when we come together to work. And sometimes we spend an hour before that, though, just catching up, talking about those deeper things in our lives, because it's important to us. How can we talk to you guys about going deep if we're not going deep with each other?
Right.
So to do this, though, you need to schedule that time. And not only that, but schedule it to be distraction-free time.
Right.
Not multitasking, not looking at your phone, focused time. I think this is a very, very lost art. Go out to dinner with somebody and leave your phone in your purse or your pocket and see how awkward that feels for a while. I'm challenging you all.
I have a coffee group that I meet with once a week, and the rule there is no cell phones unless we're actually looking up something that we're all talking about. But the minute we find the information we want, the phones go back into the purses or into our pockets or whatever. So look at your friendships now, like my coffee group, like those friends who are around you. Are any of those relationships in a deep place? Who can you cultivate to be in a deep relationship with, to go beyond the surface? And what friendships that you have now actually lead you into superficiality? Look at how you spend your time now. If your day is spent largely interacting with superficial things like TV and all those things we've talked about, that's just going to lead you to be a more superficial person. Yeah. Spend time in activities that cultivate deeper thinking, deeper relationships, and deeper connections.
And when we're talking about scheduling time, schedule time with yourself, you know, schedule time to think, to reflect, time to evaluate your day, evaluate your life, to reflect on the sermon at church. How many of us really think about the sermon later, or your Bible study, or whatever scripture you're memorizing? Don't skim the surface. Take the time to think about the implications of what you're reading, hearing, learning. That's going to help us put truths into practice.
Be the one to take the risk, guys. It's worth it. Drop the mask. Be vulnerable. I'm telling you, it's freeing. Don't miss out on the freedom God has for you or the relationships God has for you. There's risk, but there's so much reward. Chances are people around you want to do the same. Chances are they feel alone, but they don't know how to get past that superficiality. Step out and show them.
And brave the pain of going deeper yourself. We talked about the cost being pain sometimes. So bring tissues, you know, have your dog nearby for therapy. Do this because the only way out of the pain is often quite through it and right down the middle. And so often we don't want to do that. We're like, there's no light at the end of that tunnel. But I'm telling you, really, you start walking that way and the door just opens then and you get out of that pain a lot sooner than you think. You just don't see it. You don't know that's coming, but it will.
Also, be willing to brave the pain of others. Be with them. You don't have to have all the answers. You just have to be willing to listen. Sometimes the best thing you can give someone in pain is silence, just being with them. Give them a safe place to be real and vulnerable, an arm around the shoulders. Or think about recent tragedies that have been national or even international. Do you know we're conditioned to focus on this kind of tragedy for a matter of minutes, and that's it. And then next, wham, everything is about the story behind the story.
Yeah.
Who was the shooter's girlfriend? And what are the various political parties doing? This party did this and it's their fault. No, this party did this and it's their fault. And all of this garbage information that doesn't actually help those who are hurt or suffering. So don't settle for that. Start asking yourselves the hard questions. Look away from the screens, whatever that screen is, and ask yourself, what can I do in a feet on the ground sort of way to help those who are suffering? Maybe it will cost you something to help. Be willing to do that. And what is God asking me to do? I guarantee you, he's not asking you to watch TV or be online and get the superficial details and then click on the next link and get more superficial details and so on and so on. Maybe you need to spend concentrated time in prayer for those who are suffering. Maybe there are other things he's asking you to do, but there's no way you can know what those are if you're busy clicking on links and getting more superficial garbage. So next time, we'll talk about how all this relates to writing. We are, after all, write from the deep. So how do you go beyond what's superficial and write from those deep and honest places? We've spent time in this podcast laying groundwork, and then we're going to jump in the next podcast into the ways that you can make changes so that your writing will become powerful and will impact people in ways that you never imagined because you're writing from vulnerable, honest places. Until then, work on the things we talked about today. Open yourself up. Be vulnerable. Be the one to take the risk. You're going to be delighted with what God shows you and how he changes your life.
Amen.
Amen. Thanks for listening today. We hope you found it helpful.
You might also like the backlist episodes, which you can find along with a free audio download, 5 Crucial Ways to Safeguard Your Writer's Heart, at our website, writefromthedeep.com.
If you'd like to support the show, and we would love it if you'd do that, you can contribute through the website.
To connect with us, go to the website or tweet us at KarenBall1, that's the number one, or Erin T. Young.
So until next time,
embrace the deep.
Your writing and your life will never be the same.
Amen.
Amen.